Okay, good afternoon, everybody. I'm Bob Hanson. I'm the Chief Executive Officer of UPCEA. We're the Association for Leaders in Professional Continuing and Online Education. I'd like to begin by thanking Senator Susan Collins for hosting this event. We're very appreciative. I'd also like to thank everybody for coming today and to the hundreds of folks who are watching via webcast. The purpose of the event today is twofold. First, to create a sense of urgency about the importance of the adult learner, not only to the future of higher education, but to America's economic competitiveness. And second, to introduce the National Adult Learner Coalition to stakeholders on the Hill and to the more than 1,000 colleges and universities that our organizations represent. I think it's fair to say that today's higher education policy framework still largely resembles what it looked like when HEA was passed more than 50 years ago in 1965, when most students were still traditional age, full time, and living in the dorms. We believe that we need to modernize higher education policy to reflect the new reality that the vast majority of today's learners no longer fit this profile. It's also true that most colleges and universities are still organized around their historic mission of serving traditional learners. This, too, has to change for many of these institutions to remain sustainable, particularly the regional public and private colleges and universities that are so dependent upon adult learners. In spite of this long overdue need for change, there has been no single unified voice for the adult learner within the higher education establishment in Washington until now. UPSEA has formed the coalition with three other organizations in the adult higher education sector, the Online Learning Consortium, OLC, the Council for Adult and Experiential Learning, CAEL, and the President's Forum. Each of our organizations brings a unique expertise to the table, whether it's professional continuing education, online learning, alternative credentials, or prior learning assessment. Together, we're able to leverage our unique strengths, amplify our individual voices, and advance the adult learner agenda. So why are adult learners so important, not just to higher education policy, but to public policy generally? In some ways, it's a simple numbers game. According to Georgetown University Center for Education and Workforce, 65% of jobs will require a college degree or post-secondary credential by 2020, which is just 3 years away. This reality poses a daunting math problem. The current pipeline of traditional age students is simply not large enough to meet our national requirements. And if our country's employers don't have access to skilled labor, it will be difficult to remain competitive on the international stage. Expanding opportunities for adult learners is therefore not only a potential solution to this formidable challenge, it is the most obvious and compelling solution. Clearly, then, the time to ensure that adult learners have access to programs and services to help them succeed is more important now than ever. Now I'd like to introduce the man whose work I just cited, Anthony Carnevale, to my right, your left. Dr. Carnevale currently serves as research professor and director of Georgetown University Center for Education and Workforce, a position he's held since the center was established in 2008. Previously, while serving at the Educational Testing Service, Dr. Carnevale was appointed by President George W. Bush to serve on the White House Commission on Technology and Education. And before joining ETS, Dr. Carnevale was a director at the Committee for Economic Development. While at CED, Carnevale was appointed by President Clinton to chair the National Commission on Employment Policy. So you can see, Tony has been used as a valuable resource by both Republican and Democratic administrations. And rightly so. Tony's work on the public policy connections between American higher education and the workforce is the gold standard, and we're lucky to have him share a few words with us today. Before I turn the microphone over to Tony, just a brief note on the structure. After Tony, we're going to have Becky from the from CAEL introduce John Cavanaugh, who will talk about the way that diverse institutions are meeting the needs of working adults. And then we'll finish with Monique Wardrick, who is an exemplary adult learner herself, and she'll share with us her journey and some of the obstacles she faced along the way. Then we'll open it up for questions. So, Tony.
Can you hear me? The little red light is on. means I'm on. There is some, sitting in this room puts me in mind of the history on this question, some of which was acted out in this room, I can tell you, in committee hearings when I worked here in the 1970s. And back then, we lived in a world pretty much where people got their job training on the job. So in those years, most Americans were either high school graduates or high school dropouts. That is, most, and an even larger share of working Americans were high school grads or high school dropouts, and they did just fine. Most of them were in the middle class. It's that old industrial economy that is in our rearview mirror now, but at that time, it provided the jobs for the mass of us, and a relatively small share of us required any kind of education or training beyond high school in a formal sense. In those days, the primary job trainer was the employer. So back then, and it was a much smaller economy and a much smaller workforce, employers spent about $30 billion a year on formal training and another $150 billion or so on informal job training, as estimated by economists. What happened was fairly striking. That is, that economy wasn't working, we had a major recession in 1980-81, double-dip recession, and thereafter, inflation was banished from the economy, and capital began to move again, and we saw a massive investment in what was essentially a new economy, a post-industrial economy that was largely driven by service jobs. And most of the value added in that economy comes from service functions on the job, so that the stuff you make has relatively little value now compared to what it had in the 1970s. Most of the value in your iPad, all but probably 10%, comes from service employees, service professionals, most of whom, a substantial majority of whom, have some education beyond high school. Maybe 10% comes from the manufacturing of the iPad and the materials that are dug out of the ground or wherever they're found that makes the iPad. So we live in a world now that has changed fundamentally. One of those changes is that education and training beyond high school became more and more necessary. Back in the 1970s, when we confronted unemployment and industrial decline, the first instinct in this room was to build a national training system. There was a history there. It began with something called Neighborhood Youth Corps in the late 1960s, and then became the Manpower Development and Training Act in the late 1960s, early 70s. By the mid-70s, it became the Comprehensive Employment and Training Act. And the intention in those days was to build a training system alongside our education system, alongside our post-secondary education and training system. And many of the people involved, including me, thought at some point it would rival the post-secondary, the higher education system, as we would have called it back then. The fact that we call it the post-secondary education and training system now tells you what happened, which is that CETA failed. It was sort of naive on our part to believe that we were going to build an institution of the size of American higher education to provide a training function for Americans. It was something we learned from the Europeans. They were quite successful in building a training system alongside a smaller higher education system. That didn't work out in America. As a result, we now have a $400 to $500 billion higher education system. And what we discovered with CETA and programs thereafter, CETA became, I think it became Job Training Partnership Act, and then it became the Workforce Investment Act is what it is now. If we had, if we funded CETA at the rate we were funding it in the mid-70s, it would be now funded at about $30 to $35 billion. That's with no growth. That's just correcting for inflation. The Workforce Investment Act is about $7 billion or $5 or $6 billion. So in the end, what happened is this function, this training function, shifted to the education side of the street. One more piece of data which has always been striking to me is in 78, function 500, which is the function of the federal budget, budgets divided up into functions as it's both by the administration and the Congress, and function 500, which was education, training, employment, and social services spending and tax expenditures, in function 500 in the mid-70s, 40% of the money after we built CETA in function 500 was not in higher education, was not in K-12 education. It was in training. So now the training in function 500, which is where all the federal support of training in, which is most of the support for training, the states really don't add much money. They take the first and last federal dollar and don't match it for training functions. It's now 6%. So clearly we had a shift. There was an implicit decision made, I would argue, as early as the Clinton administration with the failure of CETA to the Comprehensive Employment and Training Act to shift this function to the higher education system. And everybody pointed toward the two-year, the community colleges were the obvious candidates, because we all knew, as everyone's always known about community colleges, is that they do things cheaper and faster than four-year institutions. So we gave them the job because they provided cheap training. In the end, it's one of the reasons why the training they do is so often unsuccessful, I think. That's the dirty little secret. That is, so in the end, the world changed, and the higher education system, without being told, I think, actually, became the nation's workforce development system. It is still trying to assume that mission, and in many cases, it fights it tooth and nail. So that now the higher education system is, in fact, a workforce development system. All graduate degrees are focused on particular occupations, even occupations where there are no jobs, like college professor. The four-year degrees, 70 to 80% of them, however you count, are in occupational fields, is about 20% in STEM, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. Assumedly, if you take chemistry, you're supposed to be a chemist. If you take biology, you're supposed to be a biologist, although most people with biology degrees don't become biologists because there aren't that many jobs for biologists, which is a recurring problem with higher ed, is even when we do job training, we don't train people for jobs that are actually there. You got another 30% that are business or business-related degrees. You got another 10% that are education degrees. You got another 4 or 5% that are basically, in the end, psychology translated into counseling and social work, and so on. So, and then when you go down to the two-year schools, you do have the two-year AA, the transfer degree, the general degree. It has very low earnings returns, unless you do transfer and complete a BA, but you have the Associate of Science and the Associate of Applied Science, and then this huge growth in certificates, which are now the largest award given in post-secondary education and training. And the latest entries in the game are the industry-based certifications, Microsoft certificate and so on, and certificates that you get to run a crane on a construction site, certifications that you get. And in those cases, what we know is that a good 40% or so of the courses taken to pass those exams, certifications are exam-based, not seat time-based, comes from post-secondary institutions, four-year and two-year. So there's a proposal that keeps floating around for several years now to recognize, give credit, and fund course clusters that end up giving people certifications. And then in higher ed, there's a fairly substantial share of non-credit education, which is basically customized job training, oftentimes done for employers, or with very strong attachments to occupational labor markets. so that, and educators are very leery of making that education because in those course clusters, in that non-credit education, in the certificates, it doesn't sound much like Shakespeare. So educators are not friendly to that part of their own business, but it is a larger and larger part of their business, is as has already been shown, the traditional on-campus residential student is very much a minority in the American post-secondary education and training system. The adults have really sort of taken over, and we know that even for young people, it takes between the ages of 18 and 32 to finally arrive at a career job in a labor market. So, and the pathway that gets you there is both formal learning and informal learning on the job through work experience, internships, and so on. So what's really happened is that post-secondary education, which has a profound mission in a democratic society to promote human flourishing, to promote learning that has intrinsic value, promote learning for its own sake, has another mission now, because in a capitalist economy, you can't become a lifelong learner unless you're a lifelong earner. In a capitalist economy, you got to get a job. And we use higher education, it ain't necessarily so, but we use higher education as our workforce development system. So the evolution of that idea is what you're all in the middle of. We just had an election where essentially a lot of the Trump voters are people who didn't get retrained. The Sanders voters were people who knew they had to be trained and wanted it for free and don't see why they have to pay as much as they do for it, which all of that puts enormous pressure on the post-secondary education system and the traditional higher education system to serve this function and integrate it with its other functions, because it has other functions. Higher education should be a place where the power of government and economies aren't preeminent, a safe haven from the power of government and the power of economics. So it's gotten more complicated. The way we've resolved it is by using college majors, because majors are what you sell that other 60% of your coursework to get a BA, similarly with an AA, proportionally. That other 60% is that general education that's supposed to allow you to flourish as a human being, not supposed to make you money. So that's the contest. The way we're handling it, truthfully, in America, is that more and more that hybrid, the gold standard, the bachelor's degree, the two-year degree, those are more and more for people who seem to be getting whiter and whiter and richer and richer. And more of the expansion in what I would call, to say it in a way that, what I would call job training or workforce development or career preparation, however you want to use the words, more and more that goes to minorities, working class, and low-income kids. So we are moving on this problem, but we're moving on it in a way that creates huge racial and class stratification. Not to say there's an easy way out of this. The demand for job-related learning, career-related learning, has not stopped. The wage premium for the value of education beyond high school relative to the value of high school started out at about 30% by 1980, at the end of the 70s. It rose to about 84%, depending on which data you use. It stayed there ever since, even through the recession. The value of post-secondary learning declined in absolute terms. Everybody, BAs and graduate degrees included, lost about $6,000 in earnings in the recession. But the relative difference between high school certificates, two-year degrees, four-year degrees, and graduate degrees remained the same. So for an individual, the choices are the same. The other piece of this that is stunning to me in the major statistical change since the early 80s is not so much that the value of post-secondary went up, which it did, but the variation in value went up many times more. So we essentially doubled the average value of post-secondary education and training over high school, but the differences by field of study increased even more, so that, you know, engineers make five times as much as social workers and early childhood educators. And those are two distinctive majors at the BA level, so that 40% of people with bachelor's degrees make more than people with graduate degrees now, depending on their field of study. 30% of AAs pay more than bachelor's degrees, depending on the field of study. There are lots of one-year certificates that pay more than bachelor's degrees and even graduate degrees in fields like education. So we're living in a world where the economy has articulated its relationship to the post-secondary education and training system. It's a $500 billion enterprise. A lot of people want in. One of the things we're seeing is that there are more and more people being let in. And where we're headed, I think, is a system where, given the workforce demands, the real issue is, when are we going to get accountability? When are we going to hook up all education and training programs to wage records and figure out which programs, majors, fields of studies, degrees, certificates, all the rest of it, badges, whatever else you want to throw in the pot, do they or don't they get you a job and make you money? And if they don't, you can still use, at least the bias at the moment is, if you want to go to Georgetown and take classics, you can do so, but Georgetown's got to tell you that that's not going to make you rich.
I think that's on now. My name is Becky Klein Collins, and I'm the Associate Vice President for the Council for Adult and Experiential Learning. And thank you very much for your remarks. I think a lot of what you said is really underscoring some critical points that we want you to be taking away from you. One is how important higher education post-secondary credentials are for the entire workforce, and how complex our current system is, and to some extent not understandable to the average adult who may want to improve their current situation, may want to follow a different career pathway that's going to lead them to greater employability, long-term employability, and success in this labor market. But you know, we know how important it is for so many adults to take advantage of learning opportunities, and how important it is going to be to help more Americans regain a foothold in the middle class jobs through education. But we need to also face facts that even though the whole training system has sort of merged with the higher ed system, it's still relatively difficult for adults to pursue post-secondary degrees on average, because we're talking about people who are by and large already employed. They have families, too. So they have children that they're caring for. They have elderly relatives. Sometimes they have both. So these are the people that we want to see succeed in post-secondary education. We want to see them go back to school. But we have to be realistic about what they can be expected to do. We can't expect them to go back to school in the traditional way, full-time during the day on a set schedule. For education to work for them, they need something very different. They need flexible programming, evenings, weekends, online, accelerated, self-paced, modular. Very different kinds of learning options that will fit their busy lives and allow them to keep supporting their families as they go to school. What may not be well known is that if these adults look hard and if they know where to look, they can find those flexible options. What has always been special about the U.S. higher education system is that individual institutions have the ability to define their own missions and their programs. The result is that we have many institutions that serve primarily traditional age students, but we also have many institutions who are offering new kinds of programs to serve adults and other non-traditional learners better. We see more and more innovations in instructional delivery and scheduling. And this is particularly important for the working adult who may have an unpredictable work schedule. We see new programs using direct assessment and self-paced formatting. We see innovative methods for awarding credit based on what a student knows and not just on whether they sat through a particular course. Yet in many respects, these offerings exist somewhat on the margins. They're not universally available. Our current financial aid system is not set up to support them fully. And furthermore, adults rarely get much guidance in understanding what the range of possible options are. And I think that leads to some of the inequalities that we're seeing that Tony talked about in terms of who ends up with what kinds of degrees. So federal policies to support the adult learner really need to be strengthened and reimagined given the new realities of the labor market and the larger economy. Our federal higher education policies were created, as Tony mentioned, in a time when innovative delivery options and other innovations for the adult learner didn't exist. So when the Higher Education Act is reauthorized, and we hope that it will be soon, it really needs to be redesigned to support more than just the traditional student. Similarly, our federal workforce development policies are not nearly as robust as they need to be to support business and industry needs. According to the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, OECD, on average, European countries are spending 0.6% of their GDP on active labor market policies, while the U.S. spends only 0.1% of GDP. This is so it's not just a matter of helping people succeed in this new economy, it's really an economic imperative, and we are not really measuring up to our competitors in the global economy. This coalition that we have formed wants to point to policy opportunities that exist to better support the adult learner and a revitalized middle class so that we can meet the economic need. In education, as I mentioned, the reauthorization of the Higher Ed Act provides a great opportunity to restructure and even expand Pell Grants to support the specific ways in which adults are pursuing degrees. There are also opportunities to relax some regulations that are stifling innovation within higher ed, provided that safeguards are still in place to protect against fraud and abuse. On the workforce side, much more can be done to provide incentives for employers to invest in workforce education. In addition, there's an opportunity with the administration's possible infrastructure plan to invest in targeted training for building and construction needs, but also to enhance broadband access that will facilitate learning activities. So these policy opportunities are described in the paper that you have in front of you today, and we're glad to be able to share these with you, and we're asking that you engage with us on these policy issues and ideas going forward. So before we get to our Q&A, we'd also like you to hear from two other people here today who have some important perspectives to share. First, we have Dr. John C. Cavanaugh to talk about the perspective of colleges and universities. John is president and CEO of the Consortium of Universities of the Washington Metropolitan Area, and previously he served as chancellor of the Pennsylvania State System of Higher Education and as president of the University of West Florida. So he's got lots of different hats he can speak from. And then immediately following John, we're excited to have Monique Wardrick. Monique is an Air Force veteran, a mother, adult learner, and a recent graduate of the University of Maryland University College. So she'll share with us her experiences as an adult learner. So John, you know.
Thank you and good afternoon, everyone. I'd like to thank Senator Collins for her sponsorship and the coalition for putting on this event. And I'd especially like to thank those of you who are in the room and those of you who are watching on the webcast, because you're the important players here. I want to ask you a favor. When you get back to your offices and you talk to your members, you talk to your organization, and then come talk to the members or talk to some of the people in this room, I'd like you to think about the talking points that Tony talked about, that Becky talked about, that Monique will talk about, because we are at a very critical point in the history of higher education in this country. You heard how we got here from Tony. Back in the days of CETA, some of us remember those days better than others. But however we got here, the important point is the people who are knocking on the doors of our institutions of higher education are not 17 and 18 years old only anymore. They're all of us. They look like us. They come from all kinds of different backgrounds like we do. And they want an education. And with your help And the institutional commitments that I'll share with you some examples of, we can provide that education for the people who want it, and the people who need it, to guarantee that what we are about today will have the same effect for decades to come as the acts that Tony talked about from the 1970s, CETA and the rest, the Higher Education Act, 50 years now. 50 years that legislation is still impacting what we do. So if we think the decisions we make today don't matter, think again. Think back to the genesis of how we got to where we are today. You heard a little bit from Becky about the changes in the higher education landscape. For many of us, our experience at college was something like, well, you know, you went, there was a curriculum, you had to learn it there because you couldn't, their learning was better than everybody else's learning, right? Our courses are better than everybody else's courses. That's a general perception that's still out there. But I want to share with you some examples of how that's changing. That there is a recognition that, guess what? We learn things in all kinds of different settings. And guess what? The learning transfers. So we in higher education are trying to respond to that. We also understand, as Becky pointed out, that people have busy lives. They have complicated lives. So the notion that we have a fall, a spring, and a summer term doesn't work for everybody. It can work for some, but not for everybody. We also know that the support services that we have, financial aid offices, tutoring, figuring out which end is up, how do you register for classes, we can't close those offices at 6 o'clock anymore. We need 24/7, 365. So how are institutions responding to those challenges? Well, in the Consortium of Universities here in the DC metro area, we have 17 members. And while I'd love to tell you the wonderful things that all 17 are doing, let me just share with you four that cut across the geography of the greater Washington area, as well as cut across the different sectors of higher education. Let me tell you a little bit about what's happening in Montgomery College, out of Montgomery County, Maryland. It's a community college. So you might expect, well, gee, they obviously have a lot of kinds of job training programs and all that Tony and Becky have talked about, and they do. But I'd like to highlight something else that they do that you might not know and you might not think about. One of the things that Montgomery does is they combine programs in English for speakers of other languages, ESOL, with basic skills and content areas all together so that in one course, you get both. You get English and you get content. How does that play out? The content leads you to various kinds of certifications, for example, in healthcare, the building construction trades, and so on. Those certifications lead to additional certifications, or what we call stackable credentials. So you can start at one level, go out, get a job, come back for another certification in a related or a different field, get that certification, go back out, and so on. Stack it all the way up to a bachelor's degree. By taking that learning and transferring to a baccalaureate-level institution. Let me tell you a little bit about Trinity Washington University. Many of you know Trinity in Northeast Washington here. I don't know whether you know, however, that in addition to the main campus that Trinity has in Northeast, they also are in the ARC over in Anacostia. The ARC is the Town Hall Education, Arts, and Recreation Facility over there. They offer a full associate's degree at the ARC because that's where the students are. That program provides support for people from all kinds of different backgrounds. It helps them get all up on the level playing field academically, socially, with a support structure, and leads to an associate degree that students then can then continue to a bachelor's degree at Trinity or at somewhere else. That also provides appropriate placement exams, background assessment to figure out what does the student really know, and what's the right set of courses for that student. Over in Virginia, one of our member institutions, Marymount University, has a whole program in the Bachelor of Liberal Studies program that's a totally personalized degree. That targets people with some college, no degree. And, you know, in the Washington area, people have lived in lots of different places. Military, right? People who have moved around. You may have taken a course here, course there. Marymount will help you aggregate those credits, put you on a track to that Bachelor of Liberal Studies program, and get you on a track of success. They also have a portfolio assessment of learning that you might have had through your job that then leads to credit for internship at Marymount as another way to give you credit for what you know so that you don't have to retake courses that you don't need to take. And finally, got to put in a plug for Georgetown. Georgetown operates the School of Continuing Studies over here on Massachusetts Avenue, not far from where we are right now, actually, that also offers a program in liberal studies. What Georgetown has really focused on is raising the number of credits that a student can transfer in. Historically, institutions are really bad at that. They might allow you to transfer a handful of credits, but that's not going to work for adults anymore. So what did Georgetown do? Raise that number to 64. It's a little bit more than half the credits for the degree. Much more flexible than you would expect at institutions like that. The courses there are offered in a multiple delivery formats, face-to-face, hybrid, online, so that it can better fit in the schedule of the working adults. Those are only four of the many, many examples of the member institutions in the consortium. Love to talk to you in more detail. You can check out the individual institutions through our website. But I'd also like to emphasize to all of you who can make a difference in your daily conversations, access to financial aid that Becky talked about is critical. Putting these programs together means ability to pay and ability to afford those credentials. Making Title IV aid more flexible is the key. We would love to be able to work with you. The white paper provides some good examples of and good suggestions on how to do that. But I just again like to thank you all for coming today, for listening, for caring. For those of you who are here and on the website, we'll all be here to answer questions, and I know that we'll be available to you after the event as well. Thank you so very much.
Good afternoon. My name is Monique Wardrick, and I'm here to share some snapshots of my personal journey in the hopes of giving you perspective on some of the challenges and choices that adult learners face. Okay, so my path is littered with lots of false starts, missteps, and probably more twists than an episode of Scandal. But it culminated in me earning an associate's degree from Prince George's Community College in 2013 and a Bachelor of Arts in Communication Studies from University of Maryland University College in 2016. So it paid off eventually at the ripe old age of 46. But to give you some context, I'd like to share first that I'm a native New Orleanian. I came up in the family that was extremely supportive, but we weren't a family of means. And I consider myself to be a really solid product of the public school system in New Orleans. I made it into one of the most exemplary magnet programs in the city. But even with that, and even with individuals who profess to recognize my potential, at the end of the day, it still came down to dollars and cents. And if you didn't have the money for college in 1988, and you didn't have the resources to help you navigate financial aid back then, you did what I did, which was work two jobs and struggled through for a year and a half, and eventually fell away. Now, I took a hiatus from college thinking, okay, I'm just going to stop. I'm going to save up some money. I'm going to go back. When one semester turned into three, I realized I needed to do something different. So I joined the Air Force with the intent on figuring out my path and also with the hope of returning to school eventually. Along that path, I found myself in a marriage, parent to two children, and anybody in here who has kids or a spouse knows nothing puts things on the back burner like family. So college was something that got set aside. When my enlistment was done, I was in the Washington, D.C. metro area. I went to Prince George's Community College. I was on the dean's list. I earned merit scholarships. And then the realities of divorce and my son's autism diagnosis, that it reintroduced that back burner again. And that was fine. I found myself in a career in intellectual property as a legal assistant, which was a very rewarding career. I was able to provide splendidly for my children. I was able to help family, so much so that family members moved into the area for me so that I could go back to school. And then 6 months later, Hurricane Katrina devastated my hometown. So 6 months after returning to school, I had a contingency of 11 family members that I was able to get into the area, and I can only tell you that it was awesome. We had fun. When you have that much New Orleans in one house, every day is a cookout, every night's Mardi Gras, a clean G-rated version of Mardi Gras. So it's impossible to look at family members that love you and support you and say, I know that you're going to have to rebuild your life, but I'm back in school, so I don't have the time, resources, or financial resources to commit to you. It wasn't a contest. School got set aside, and it took 7 years before I could even look at the opportunity again as something that might be plausible for my life. In the end, it was looking at my children, which had grown to four in a blended family, and realizing that if I demonstrate the discipline and the fortitude to just press through it, no matter how busy I am, what it would mean for them. I also had the support of a husband who wouldn't leave me alone about it because he knew what my aspirations were. And so in looking into programs, University of Maryland University College was probably the only program where the construct was such that I could have a busy career and still make it happen. It wasn't a spring, summer, fall semester setup. There were so many different offerings as far as whether you want to take it as a four-week course or if you're going to take it on weekends, hybrid, everything. And that's exactly what I needed. As a workaholic who was working 60 hours a week, I needed something that would allow for flexibility in my schedule, and it did. And so here I am a few years later, earned the degree. Now I'm in the graduate program at UMUC, pursuing a master management for public relations. The thing is, would I have gotten here sooner if there were constructs in place that made it easier for me to get credit for the work I'd already done, for the work experiences that I brought to the classroom? The problem with a lot of institutions is you have to do as much work as taking the class in order to get that credit. If I have to pay out of pocket for a portfolio course that at the end of it you tell me whether or not I get credit for this class, well, I may as well take the class. And that's what a lot of students are facing. I'm a strong advocate for just the people in my community and my family to, no, let's all go back to school. Let's all get this done. There are probably six cousins that are adult learners at some of the area schools just off the encouragement from myself and my husband. But they're all facing the same challenge. Well, I've worked in computers for the last 13 years, but in order for me to get this credit, I have to do, nah, that's okay, I'll just take the class, it'll be an easy A. But how much faster could they have gotten to their goal if they're able to get that credit a little bit sooner? And so see, these are some of the challenges that adult learners face, that navigating life. If there were more incentives in place for employers to allow for greater flexibility or to, well, here's a crazy idea, help reimburse their employees to earn their degrees, it's only going to make for a better workforce. I'm a better employee because of my work product, and my work product is better because of my education. And so these are the considerations that can't be ignored, especially in the face of the reality that most of the people in my classes are around my age. You know, it's not Animal House anymore. know, people are in school because this is how you get ahead. This is how you make a way to actually achieve your objectives. It doesn't happen because you spend 30 years at a company and eventually they recognize that you've sat at that desk or you've, you know, contributed these memos. It's because you've gone out, you have insulated the work you do with credentials. And so this is it, folks. This is the face of your adult learner. And I thank you very much for the opportunity to speak with you and share my story. And I hope that it helps in whatever possible legislative changes could happen to make it easier for adult learners, which is a growing class, to be affirmed in their pursuits. Thank you.
So we all talked in advance and nobody wanted to follow her. At last, it came to me to wrap this up. I wanted, I think we do have a few minutes. Actually, we have about 10 minutes for questions. We're going to take questions from the audience, but also anybody who's chiming in from the webcast. Just a reminder to everybody, let's repeat the question from the audience for the benefit of the webcast so that they can hear it because there's no microphone out there. So anybody with any questions, comments? In the back. In terms of dollars? Okay, the question is, has the amount of financial support for adult learners increased over time? Anybody here know that? Tony, do you know that the answer to that question?
So if we were, the answer is yes and no. I'm sorry, I'm an economist, so I have always have it on the one hand and on the other. Adult learning per se, no. Any kind of adult, basically the three programs, English as a second language, basic adult skills, adult basic education, and the third is remediation of some kind. They're pretty much, I think they sit at around, I don't want to hazard a guess, but they've always been somewhere. In the current budget, I think they're around $800 million, maybe up to a billion. I don't know. They're just like the career and technical education programs. They're at about a billion. But they've not grown at all in overall funding, if you look over the decades since the 70s. So they've lost 2 to 4% a year ever since. So it's a net decline that is really very substantial. But the other question then becomes, given that training per se went from 40% to 6% of federal spending on education, training, employment, and social services, how much adult education is now in four-year and two-year colleges and funded through Title IV as opposed to the three major adult education programs, adult and continuing education programs? And the answer there is a lot. That is, higher education has expanded, as I said, to a $400 to $500 billion institution. If you ask anybody, whether they're youth or adults, why they go, 80% so they say the number one reason is so they can have a career. Number two is so that they can make more money. Number three is they want to learn things that interest them. Number four is they want to be better people. That's at about 30% of the respondents. So, you know, there is a So teasing out the adult education component of Title IV funding, that would argue, if you do it that way, adult education has grown a lot. That is, more and more people who get access to Title IV funding are in fact adults. So I think on net, yes, it's grown a lot because higher education has taken on this function.
My understanding as well is that Pell Grants are primarily reserved for fall, spring terms, full time. And that has not helped the adult learner, because the adult learner, by and large, takes one or two classes at a time. And as Becky was saying, they need to go to school year-round, including the summers. And so one of the things we're really supportive of is a year-round Pell. There was a push to do that last year. At the end of the day, it didn't happen. So there are a lot of other questions in the audience. Yes. Yeah, that's a great question. It was a comment, first of all, that the adults face such a difficult obstacle in figuring out the maze of finance and what would be an ideal structure if we could come up with one. Anybody want to handle that on the panel?
Well, I just want to say that, yeah, Pell is part of the answer, but you're right, it is not enough. I mean, you know, in those countries that, if you look at the OECD report, you know, these are countries where they have kind of a longer history of employers being having a very different relationship with education than we do. So part of it is trying to find ways to kind of reimagine that relationship here and incent employers to work with education in a very different way. As investors in the workforce rather than consumers, you know, one of the things is that we have set up a system where our educational system is sort of producing the finished product, right? In a lot of countries, and I think it's good that we have high expectations of our, you know, of our graduates and program completers, but at the same time, you know, there needs to also be some engagement with the employer and recognition of their role as, you know, investors, not consumers of this product only.
One comment on that. That idea has a very specific political history, and that is that the first promise in the 72-73 Higher Ed Act, when we started student aid, there were two goals. One was access to higher education. The second goal was choice. The reason the Congress was able to pass that bill is because the elite four-year schools were brought in, because in those days tuitions were low enough so that you could actually argue that a Pell Grant would get you most of the way towards your full need. Maybe some of you know that data over the years. That's less and less. That's absolutely not true anymore. So you can't go to Georgetown on a Pell Grant. In the end, that came up early on. It became very apparent through the 70s as the prices rose, especially at the four-year schools, that choice was not an option, that the Pell Grant was not big enough to give people real choices so that they could go to get a Pell Grant and go to Harvard. That wasn't going to happen. Choice fell off the table. Nobody really talks about it anymore. Now it's access and completion is the new shtick. So, but in the meantime, along the way, and originally in 70, in the original bill, it did say that Title IV could fund education that was not, didn't lead to further education, could fund job training, okay? It still says that, by the way. That's where the phrase gainful employment comes from, is a very talented and hardworking staff person, and for all of you who follow gainful employment, and the Obama administration found that in the 72 or the 73 law and brought it forward to policy in the Obama years. A very creative act, in my judgment. But in any event, literally in those days, a congressman from Michigan inserted into the higher ed bill the requirement that people who went in for unemployment insurance or who signed up for AFDC payments, welfare, especially for welfare moms, had to fill out a Pell Grant application. The higher education lobby moved in and wiped all that away in subsequent reauthorizations. Their argument, and it's still the argument, it came up again in the Obama years, in the Clinton years, the president wanted to use Pell as a job training voucher as well. The answer from the Ed Department is always, and aggressively, and they've always won, is that if you do that, you have to reduce the maximum grant. And the maximum grant is valuable not so much to the elite schools anymore, mm-hmm. but to middle-tier four-year colleges, so that mm-hmm. if you're going to make this a training or a job retraining or job-related voucher, Pell, you're going to have to reduce the maximum grant in Pell. Either that or spend an awful lot more money on Pell than we spend now. So it always, Clinton tried, in the end he failed. That is, his own administration beat him, and then on the Hill. And then secondly, Obama finessed it by sending a letter to all the unemployment insurance offices and to the financial aid people in all higher education institutions saying, if somebody who's unemployed comes through the door, I don't want you to consider their prior income when you're filling out the Pell form. You've considered their current income, which would make a lot more people eligible. So mm-hmm. he's the only person that managed to throw that pitch and get a strike in 40 years.
Thank you. We have enough time for one or two. If we keep our answers quick, I think we have another time for two questions. You in the back? Yeah, the question is about not just about access and financial aid, but what about job placement? I can tell you this, that you, as the CEO of UPSEA, I hear this all the time from schools of continuing studies or schools of professional studies that they're really exploring how to do a better job of job placement, because in the past, most of the adult-facing organizational structures are at universities were reliant upon the centralized career services placement, which are woefully unprepared for really assisting adults in that complicated process. But they're starting to explore ways to do it themselves. There's a lot of companies that have actually been developing that service as well. In terms of the policy, does anybody want to tackle the policy dimension of that? I'm talking about how it's happening and how it's playing out at our own member institutions.
Sure. In the consortium, there's been massive change in that. Montgomery College that I gave an example about earlier, it's hand in glove. The minute the student gets there, they get them connected to the career services office. Many institutions, right as students matriculate, the minute they hit campus, they get them connected to the career services folks, and then they journey together, both with the academic advisor and the career advisor, all the way through that student's educational experience.
Can I just add one additional point, which is, you know, I think we saw some efforts over the last couple of years with the introduction of the college scorecard to share information about not just graduation rates of individual colleges, but also, you know, long-term earnings potential and what happens to people who graduate and what do they do earn. These are not perfect measures, but I think the intent was to shine a spotlight on this issue and you know, put some pressure on the institutions to focus on this a little bit more.
Thank you. Do we have one from the webcast? Yeah, this sounds like a Kale question.
But something other than a portfolio, sort of a...
Something other than
class. Yeah, something that rather than portfolios, rather thinking of a measure directed exactly at the outcomes required for specific occupational learning.
Well, that's awfully specific, but you might want to talk about CBE as well.
This is a complex question. One response to this, and I'll just give this one example.
Could you repeat the question first?
Oh, I'm sorry. I will try. It's a really long question. I think the question was if there are alternatives being put in place to recognize a student's prior learning without having to go through a portfolio, and if the skills that are that the students have don't quite fit a CLEP test. So I want to give the example of what's happening in a lot of schools across the country when it comes to returning veterans. And what we see that there are, you know, a lot of schools who will accept ACE credit recommendations that have evaluated their military training and award credit for that. But they're there's also an effort to do something that's more along the lines of a crosswalk so that a specific military occupation will be evaluated in terms of skills and competencies that the people who held those positions in the military would have. And then comparing that with the skills and competencies that a particular degree or credential program would be training their students in. And when there is overlap, to do sort of a crosswalk, so basically provide advanced standing to anyone who held that position in the military so that they don't have to complete XYZ course, but they start like halfway through and then finish, and basically it's kind of like a little mini stackable credential, so that their military training gets counted as sort of the step one in their credential, and then they take courses that build on that rather than having to take individual courses again. So I think that's one way that institutions are doing this. Of course, you have to have kind of a critical mass of people with the same set of skills, and so that's the challenge.
One last comment from John, and we'll wrap it up.
Yeah, another alternative to that is institutions that have gone to competency-based programs, education, whichever. To the extent that they've instituted direct assessment, you can just plug into the direct assessment right away and figure out where you are in along that continuum as well.
Exactly. Again, I want to thank everybody. This has been a great event. Thank you for joining us here today. Thank everybody on the webcast for joining us. And I want to please join me in thanking this wonderful panel.